Welcome, my friends, to the most complete fear review on the market. Yes, sir, I have everything you need. PC requirements, game review, gameplay, visuals, sound, 32-inch LCD, 15-inch CRT, why not? Fear was developed by Monolith Productions, the same studio that brought us classics such as Blood, No One Lives Forever, Alien vs. Predator, Throne, Middle-Earth Shadow of Mordor and Shadow of War. Ok, I'm hooked. If Monolith develops a game, I feel obliged to play. And the name of the game is Fear, a clever acronym that symbolizes the two things that permeate this shooter. Those two being dark horror and frantic action. Fear, as in the emotion, of which you will experience plenty, shows us the atmosphere of the game. And First Encounter Assault Recon, the acronym, gives us a glimpse of how the gameplay will unfold. You first encounter, then assault, and afterwards do some recon. Let's have a look at the case. We have this creepy little girl right here, the fear part, which is not at all inspired by cursed little girls from Japanese legends. We have The Grudge, of course, the American movie, but that was inspired by the Japanese horror franchise Ju-On, created by Takashi Shimizu, who also aided in The Grudge, but this is beside the point. At the bottom of the case, we have these heavy armored soldiers that seem very friendly, which, according to the developers, have combat adaptable AI. We will see. And so, we have the five integral parts of this story. The little girl who is the soldiers that you'll end up fighting, a strange man with strange appetites by the name of Fetal, the Armacham Technology Corporation, a multinational conglomerate that does research and development for military applications, a company that surely upholds high ethical and professional standards. And finally, there's you, the one you are playing, Point Man, because all you do is point and shoot. It says this on the back, a game that all PC gamers should play. Yes, but a game that not all PC gamers are able to play, because you'll see. For example, let's start with the minimum requirements computer, which, as stated by Monolith themselves, are a Pentium 4 clocked at 1.7 GHz or equivalent, 512 MB of RAM, and a 64 MB GeForce 4 Ti or Radeon 9000 video card. And I'm going to use this beautiful GeForce 4 Ti 4200 AGP 8X 64 MB of DDR video memory. I've played around 2 hours on this configuration and the game is the retail DVD version, more exactly 1.0.8. Although Fear is intended to have horror vibes, it's still good that you have a team behind you, that, although it does not follow you into battles, at least communicates permanently with you. It lowers the tension somewhat. What you need to understand from the get-go is that this game is very scalable in terms of graphics and performance, that is, low settings are low, you can play the game on almost any configuration, and high settings are high, you will need a beast to run it properly. I'm now using the lowest settings, 640x480 minimum, and as you can see, the game frame rate is quite ok, considering what game I'm playing. We have between 20 and 30 frames, and except for the fact that we don't have shadows, the game looks pretty good, you can say that these are bad graphics. But the frame rate drops quite heavily sometimes. You see here how it goes down to 14, but if you enable bullet time, you'll realize that the game is smoother. It feels much better in slow motion, even if you don't have high frame rate. Anyway, the problem in 2005 was not how well did Fear run on your computer. The problem was if it ran, and if it ran, you were satisfied. Believe me, I know what I'm saying. I still had an Atom XP 1700 Plus back then, the CPU from the minimum requirements. And yes, I played the game in 2005. I had just upgraded from my beloved GeForce 2 MX400 to my epic GeForce 6600 AGP, and I remember doing benchmarks in the game to see the differences in overclocking performance. Now, a common thing in this game is that you will hear the communication between the enemies, and you kind of figure out where they are, what they want to do, and that helps you to prepare. You're not taken by surprise, which is praiseworthy, nice touch. Another thing to be praised about Fear is that the action doesn't just take place in enclosed places or narrow corridors. There are also outdoor areas where you can take out the camper in you, and so the monotony is broken this way, although you won't spend much time outside. Let's go back. After a legendary battle with Iron Man, I took the epicest weapon in the game, the 10mm HV Penetrator, an automatic weapon that would have made Van Helsing jealous. It shoots 10mm steel spikes and can fix enemies in the wall. Please let me know if you've seen anything cooler than this. The game is not Half-Life, where you have to solve puzzles, where you have to think about certain things to move on. Of course, you have the occasional press the X button to open a door, or shoot a something to move on. And yeah, it's clear that once you get into this vent hole, nothing strange happens. Such as a little girl that comes towards you crawling like a rabbit dog with three legs. Why are you doing this to me, game? Why? Thank you. And so, this game makes me not wanna play it. But there are also horror scenes that don't scare you that much, which are extremely well done, like this one. The door closes, of course. Hi Alma, everything okay with you? Do you need anything? No, I'm leaving then, arrivederci. But what about performance on minimum requirements? 23 average FPS and 12 FPS 1% lows. Average FPS is almost decent. 1% lows is not, and if we look at this nice chart right here, we'll see the yellow line that represents 30 FPS, which is the Midnight Geek approved decent FPS for this game, and we can see how many times the game ran above the line, and how many times below it. Over the line it's okay, below the line not okay. The CPU appeared in 2001, the video card in 2002. Add a game extremely demanding for 2005, and considering how much technology advanced in the early 2000s, I think we have something nice here. It's good, and although this minimum requirements computer feels the heavy nature of the game seemed to run okay. Even during combat, it helps that I didn't have any stutters, and slow motion also helps, like I've said. Things move slowly, frames are perceived differently. I didn't have any stutters because the system memory wasn't used to the fullest. See here the highest points, I had 512 MB. For 2005, 512 MB is on the lower side. Probably many of us had at least 1 GB in that year. Even the memory of the video card was not used to the maximum. As you can see, out of the 64 that the card has, a maximum of 56 MB were used. 56 MB for a high-end game from 2005 is decent. Okay, wonderful. As for the CPU, as expected, it stays at 100% most of the time. I don't even see how it could be otherwise. There were select periods when it dropped below 100%, but these moments were rare in between, and who knows what happened then. The low frame rate is felt more when using precision weapons such as the Penetrator, especially if you want to score some headshots. And like any normal gamer, you want that. You grew up with Counter-Strike, the real version 1.6. Oh, what's with these monitors? Well, I wanted to play the game a few hours on each of them, and see what's the deal. A 19-inch Samsung with TN panel, and the 20-inch AIZO with SPVA panel. First of all, there are two main things. The monitor on the left has awful viewing angles. That is, everything turns black if you look at it from the wrong position or angle, as you can see. So, you have to stand in a perfect and fixed position in order to see everything. Besides, the monitor is not even very good in terms of colors. It's too saturated. The colors jump in your face, there's a big pile of everything in there. But the Samsung monitor has low input lag, doesn't have a lot of motion blur, at least too noticeable. So if you stay still, you're going to have an okay experience. On the other hand, the AIZO monitor has incredible input lag, and considering that I also have a low frame rate, it feels awkward whenever I want to move the gun and aim. It's like it has 100 kilograms. What is okay about this monitor is that it has very good viewing angles. The screen does not get dark from whatever position or angle, and the colors are vibrant and clearly defined. The contrast is very good. You can distinguish objects even in dark places. I noticed something strange. I don't know if it's a bug or not, but when I turn on slow motion, bodies are lifted from the ground. Very strange, it's like a morbid dance. After a while, the corpses disappear, but that's because I'm using low settings. This is why the game does not use a lot of video memory. Some objects disappear after a while. Enemies still shoot you even after you kill them. But this is not that big of a deal. There are enemies in Quake 2 that do the same thing, and even better, a game released 12 years earlier. We finally reached the Arma Cham corporate building. Back to office indeed. I kept walking through corridors and empty rooms. Eventually, a new kind of enemy appeared. A thing with some cylinders on the back that seems to have very good reflexes. A kind of me, just bad. On top of that, it's transparent. Hey, I don't have that power. It's not fair. When you shoot it, electricity comes out. It's kind of a hunchback flash. Of course, there are two more like him. But what's the deal with the advanced AI? Is this game the epitome of artificial intelligence in terms of shooters from the 2000s and beyond? I don't know, my friends. As always, the truth is out there. But we have footage here with the entire game, so let's see what the enemies are capable of. The most common enemies are the replica soldiers, and most of the time they work as a team. You rarely meet just one. And when I say that they work in a team, they really do. They communicate with each other information about me, about my position. I'm going to show some interesting things that the replica soldiers do. They jump over obstacles of all kinds, tables, railings. Sometimes they throw grenades to get you out of hiding. Sometimes they try to get behind you or take you by surprise. For example, this succeeded here. And this caught me by surprise. 10 seconds, I didn't know where he was shooting from. They ask for help when needed, although sometimes it's too late. That's because
his reflexes are totally off the charts.
They block your path with various objects. They know how many from their team were killed. Very interesting. They are spreading, so I can't pay attention to everyone at the same time. They slap you. They make themselves one with the wall so you can hit them. They realize you've turned down the flashlight and prepare for battle. Although some of these stuff are smoke and mirrors, they are still effective. It doesn't matter how they are implemented, and it doesn't matter if the AI is really smart or not. All that matters is that it gives you the impression that it is. But what's my impression? What's AI like in this game? Okay, good, excellent, perfect. My opinion, it's really good. Let's go further. For example, the physics of the game. Unfortunately, at minimum settings, you can't enjoy all that this game has to offer in terms of physics, which for 2005 was impressive, but which still has some lessons to offer to modern games. First, we have time, and as we learn in physics, it flows in only one direction, but it expands according to mass, gravity, and point man's reflexes?
His reflexes are totally off the charts.
I'm talking about slow motion, one of the coolest inventions in gaming history, and which in fear is taken to levels of pure art. There are not many games with better slow-mo implementation. We have a beautiful visual effect when we activate it. It looks like things are getting closer to you, some colors sprinkled here and there, and the projectiles draw lines on the screen like a brush on canvas. Not even Picasso painted more beautiful scenes. Another important aspect is how enemies and environments react during battles. Enemies die in spectacular ways, especially if you use the shotgun. The battle scenes turn into visual spectacles, with pieces of everything flying everywhere, from grenades to projectiles, flying paper, dust, pieces of wall, exploding electronics, broken windows. If you use high enough settings, all this destruction isn't going to go away. It's going to stay right there, as a testament to the visceral battle that took place. Water, although not that common in Fear, has impressive physics, reacts beautifully when you walk through it, makes waves and splashes when shooting, and my favorite part, when you throw grenades into the water. Although here we have a small bug, the water does not react to the explosions. We can't enable a lot of physics settings on the minimum requirements. For that, we're going to need a computer with the recommended requirements, which are, as stated by Monolith, a Pentium 4 3.0 GHz, I have here a Pentium 4 at 3.2 GHz. 1 GB of RAM? Sure. Will DDR2 work? Thanks. And the GeForce 6600 or 256 MB Radeon 9800 Pro. And I'm going to use a GeForce 6600, none other than a previously tested card, which you can see right here. I'll be using 1024x768 medium settings, which is a bit below what I would have expected to use in 2005, but we'll see. And I jumped straight into the fight. switching to guerrilla tactics because I took a good beating here before. Okay, I've nailed a few of them on the wall. I've also tested the two monitors on this system. Maybe if I have better frame rate, the Azo has less input lag. But at the moment, I don't have better frame rate. I'm still rocking around 20+. It's clear that for this game, we need a classic CRT or a mother monitor. That's because the game supports wide resolutions. Later, we'll also look at a modern and fast LCD and CRT. In Fear, we also have some boss battles, and although there aren't many bosses in the game, those that are annoying. Thank you, Monolith, for not letting us play the game, interrupting our fun with horror scenes or scares, or slamming us into useless fights with oversized enemies and 1 million HP. On top of that, this contraption has automatic rocket launcher. It fires 5 missiles at once. In the end, I got the better of him, but he also killed me a few times. The frame rate during the battle was horrible. I had constant drops below 15 FPS. Ah, the good old shotgun. It's always here to save our skins. Another powerful weapon in this game is the railgun, Type 7 particle weapon. So, railgun, the weapon developed by Armacham, which can literally disintegrate the flesh and blood of an enemy, leaving behind only his bones. I like that it has a very cool zoom, you can hear it when zooming. It has some kind of magnets or bearings. The sound when shooting is also sublime. Just listen to this. And that's what frying them looks like. Cool. But is the combat good in this game? And if we're at it, let's talk about gameplay. That is what you do when you play the game. Well, you basically do 3 things. You walk around like a loser until you find the door, the button or the vent hole in order to move forward. Thank you, Monolith, absolute uselessness. The second thing is combat, which I can describe in just 2 words. Intense and cinematic. It has simple mechanics, but together, somehow, they create something spectacular. Almost any battle can be unique, special, depending on how things evolve. I mean, do you dive head first with a shotgun in your hand to wipe everything out in 5 seconds, or get brutally killed in 5 seconds? Do you throw 1-2 grenades to do some damage first? Target the enemies from a distance with a penetrator or railgun? Variety is not given by something scripted in the game. It's given by what you do with what the game makes available to you. Then we have slow motion. That's because... And it's something that helps you tremendously. The game just wouldn't be the same without it. We have a certain time in which you can be under the slow-mo effect. But you can increase this time because in the game you can find 2 types of permanent boosts. A boost that increases your life and other for your reflexes. You'll find them either in accessible places, on your path, but sometimes you'll have to look for them, but it's worth it. For example, if you find many boosts that increase your reflexes, you'll be able to use slow motion quite a bit. We also have the usual things. Zoom in on some weapons, melee attacks, you can only carry 3 weapons, which gives a strategic vibe to the game, because the weapons are quite different from each other. And you have to decide what to use. And we also have some type of grenades. I don't like grenades. The battles are visceral, explosive, and visual and auditory elements combine themselves to create something amazing. This is almost poetic. The third gameplay thing is you reacting to weird scenes. Genie is coming towards you, Alma coming towards you, Fettel coming towards you, everyone comes towards you. Sometimes you only have a gun, sometimes you go in slow motion. Yeah, I'm not a big fan of these things. The gameplay is amazing, but how's the performance? Good gameplay is useless if the game runs bad. At 1024x768 medium settings, the game uses 91 MB of video card memory, which is excellent. In 2005, all cards had at least 128 MB. We have 900 MB of system memory, dangerously close to the recommended 1 GB. And we also have 29 average FPS, around 10 FPS 1%, and 0.1% lows, which is not okay. During battles, the frame rate drops quite a lot, just like the minimum requirements computer. What upsets me more is that the game is not optimized for dual-core CPUs, and although you don't notice this here, I did some tests before and came to the conclusion that performance does not increase a lot if you use 2 cores instead of 1. Just have a look here, almost no differences. It works the same as on the minimum requirements, only that now I'm using higher settings and resolutions. That's about it. It doesn't play very badly, but it's not great either. There are no stutters, which is good. Don't forget I'm still using an old hard drive. The game looks much better with high settings. It really feels like you're playing a next generation game. And with that, we end the recommended requirements round. What now? Don't worry, we've just begun. For example, what's the deal with the story? If you don't want spoilers, skip this part. I'm going to talk about the story now. Specifically, what are we doing here? Where do we come from? And where are we going? As I said in the beginning, we are playing with Point Man, and my mission is to kill a certain Paxton Fettel, a parapsychotic dude who telepathically controls a group of super soldier clones, because he had a vision in which a child tells him to kill them all. That's really rude. The man was chilling in his cell, listening to some oriental music, and suddenly this. My team and I follow Fettel through various locations until we get to Armacham Corporate Headquarters, you know, that corporation that makes weapons and all kinds of stuff for the military. While watching Fettel, I have all kinds of hallucinations with some little girl, Alma, with the delivery room with all sorts of shady stuff. While walking through these offices, we come across a laptop or two that have been hacked by my colleagues. If the laptops weren't using Arch, who explains the whole situation? And it goes something like this. Fettel was part of a top secret experiment, Project Origin, in which Fettel was raised as a child that had paranormal abilities, because you see, Fettel is the child of Alma Wade, another character with supernatural powers. But we also learned that Alma had another child. Oh no, what an unexpected turn of events. What do you think this second child is, who probably has some superpowers himself? Alma Wade, Paxton Fettel, Blaise Pascal, Point Man, as in me. Yeah, and now we believe that Fettel is controlled by Alma, and his goal is to free her, because she was imprisoned by Armacham after she became a real threat. I'm sure that her becoming a threat has nothing to do with her being experimented on. After finally meeting Paxton Fettel, I find out that I'm actually Alma's first child. Shocking! Absolutely amazing!
You and I were born from the same mother.
No, I am your brother, and out of anger I kill Fettel. RIP. I chased him the entire game just to give him a bullet and that's it. Thank you for offering me a satisfying ending to this. But Alma was freed by Harlan Wade, an Armacham scientist who was apparently her father? This story turns into a soap opera. And that's Harlan Wade, a budget Gordon Freeman. I somehow managed to destroy the reactor at Armacham that in turn tore apart the entire company. But I did not die, of course. A helicopter picked me up and I was gone. But of course, while chilling in the helicopter, Alma also appears. Again. That was the story, guys. It's not bad, it's pretty interesting, especially since the story is told through multiple storytelling techniques. But now I'm going to use a powerful computer from that period, namely an Athlon 64X2 5000+, a dual-core CPU, 2GB of RAM, and a powerful GeForce 7900GS, an almost high-end video card, a video card that I had the privilege to own in 2006. I will start with the same settings as the recommended requirements, so we can notice the differences. We have now an average FPS of 90 compared to 29 on recommended requirements and 1% LOVs of 35 compared to 10 before. So 3x higher performance. Impressive, I would say, right? Even during battles we have decent frame rate. We never go below 30. With this system we can see that Fear does not care at all about the fact that we have a dual core CPU. One core is used at 100%, the other just for show off. 5%. We have here a game from 2005 that is not optimized for dual core. Not cool. I'm convinced that performance would have been better with more CPU power, considering how many things related to the CPU we have in this game. Physics, a ton of sounds and effects, particle bouncing, shell casings and others. I switched to 1280x960 high settings. First of all, the game looks impeccable. Shadows, lights, textures, everything. And although we are not in an interesting area, we're just in an ordinary office building, yet all this together create a captivating atmosphere. Performance drops a little bit, but not too much, we'll see. The memory of the video card jumps from 90MB to 190MB, doubled just because we jump from medium to high, but the video card has 256MB, so we're covered. The system memory also jumps from 900MB to 1300 megabytes. That's why I'm using 2 giga. Average FPS dropped from 90 to 70 and 1% lows from 35 to 26, which means one thing, the CPU is not fast enough for this game and for this video card. Maybe the poor CPU could have done better with FIR using both cores, but because it only uses one core, we now have just an Athlon 64. I found Alice Wade, daughter of Harlan Wade and Alma's younger sister. Of course, Alice knew nothing of Alma's horrible experiments or about Alma's existence. Finally, a normal human being in this whole situation who will surely live to the end and will not end up eaten by Paxton Fettel, her nephew. Alice is Alma's sister, so this whole story revolves around a family, a father, two girls and two grandchildren. I told you that this was a soap opera. Let's see what's the deal with soft shadows and anti-aliasing. The game has an interesting visual option, soft shadows, an unnecessary option that kills your system, but let's see how it goes. Yes, soft shadows makes shadows softer and lowers performance from 80 to 50 FPS. Is it worth it? It's clearly that no. The scene does not change for the better, plus these are not soft shadows, these are blurred shadows. It's a strange blur that I don't like. I also have a weird feedback when I move the mouse. It seems that the engine moves slower, although I have 50 FPS. If I also enable anti-aliasing while using soft shadows, the game crumbles. The performance drops to 30 and now I have some visual artifacts. You can see how the shadows have become even blurrier. With only 4x anti-aliasing, we have around 50 FPS as opposed to 80 without, but all the jaggies disappear. It looks nice. Fear is among the last games to support EAX, special effects that blow your ears. Let's see how it sounds. If you shoot with a gun or throw grenades, without EAX it sounds clearer and louder. With EAX it sounds more tame. The same happens if you break the glass. With EX activated, the sound volume is lowered and it also misses the punchiness. The only time when it sounds better with EX is when you walk. The differences are very big. But it's also my fault that I've tested with a bad sound card, Creative ODG SE. Next time, a better card. The game on this configuration runs quite well. But it would have been embarrassing not to. The price for these components was around $2,000 back then. So we have a lot of rooms, hallways and small hallways. I think we were trolled by the level designer. Shame on him. This is just for the laughs. In fact, the game is wonderful and Monolith has created a masterpiece. For real, I'm not kidding. This game is a masterpiece. Full stop. Full stop, but also the last stop. More precisely, FIR on a modern computer. Now, this is where it's at. Does FIR run well on a modern PC? Let's find out. And that's how we're rocking FIR on a modern computer, with some pleasant elevator music. Ah, finally, peace, serenity, and knowledge.
Why are all the floors lighting up? Uh-oh. Somebody's pressing the call buttons. Get ready!
What? I don't know about you, but a grenade thrown into an enclosed space can really ruin your day. Oh no! Alice is okay. Plot armor. Well, that's some armor I would like to have. It's a tragicomic situation here. I'm in the elevator with my aunt, who is not scared at all, but instead has an extremely bored face. For her, it seems to be just a regular day at the office. We're still going up and every now and then the elevator opens in order to get me into a fight with the replica soldiers. I don't know whose idea was this, but this right here is something you will remember. As I've said, you can play FIR on a modern computer. But are there any compatibility issues? To test it on something modern, I've used the Ryzen 7 3700X CPU with GeForce GTX 1070, 32GB RAM and Windows 10. First of all, you can find the game on several digital distribution platforms. And along with the main game, there are also two expansions, Perseus Mandate and Extraction Point. If you have the retail version, the DVD, that will work on Windows 10 also, although it has Secure ROM. What you'll see next was recorded on the disc version, with the disc inserted into the optical drive, just the original game. The only thing I did was to copy a file. That's because Fear has a bad habit of having very low FPS on certain systems. It's a bug, and all you have to do is copy this file to the game folder and that's it. We'll jump from 70 to 300 FPS. There you go. Some old games can be played properly if you have more than 60 FPS. The engine gets confused, games such as Doom 3, Test Drive Unlimited and others. But Fear doesn't have this problem. You can play quietly even at 900 FPS. Some say that the game breaks at very high FPS, but I didn't notice this. I said before that you need a good monitor to enjoy Fear properly, and for this I tested two other displays, a 15-inch CRT and a 32-inch LCD. Although it has a small size, this CRT is better than the Azo display. The colors are more natural and the dark areas better defined if you turn off the light in the room. You may not notice in the video, but you'll have to trust me on this. Also, the CRT moves better and more naturally than the Samsung LCD. I have absolutely zero input lag, that's the key term when talking about CRTs. Because I couldn't help myself, I've also used this huge 32-inch LCD next to the CRT Halfling. The LCD goes to 144Hz and although it's much faster than the two at the beginning, it's still below the CRT in regard to input lag and motion blur. Let me show you just a few examples. Please tell me which of the two displays clearly shows how much ammunition I have left on the railgun. 2002 budget monitor versus 2022 mainstream monitor. Progress. In terms of resolutions, the game supports widescreen, and you can also use 4K. Great, but it should be noted that the HUD of the game will become extremely small. I've played on this 32-inch monitor for a few hours. It has a VA panel, QHD resolution, 144 refresh rate, FreeSync enabled, 16x anisotropic, 8x anti-aliasing and 4x super sample, and the game moves like a charm, between 100 plus and 300 FPS, no freezes of course. In fact, my recommendation is to play this game on a more modern system, with everything to the max, preferably at high resolutions and on a large monitor. It is absolutely delicious. Or if you have a big CRT, even better. Fear was built using the LeetTech Jupiter Extended Graphics Engine, an engine created by Monolith based on the LeetTech engine they've created in 1998. This engine has been upgraded over time and we have a lot of games based on it, including. In terms of graphics capabilities, Fear didn't have anything special that didn't already exist on the market in 2005. Things like Havoc physics, dynamic per pixel lighting, bump mapping, normal mapping, specular highlighting, motion blur, depth of field, heat haze, distortion, but it matters not only what you have, but also how you use it. And Fear can be described as a spectacle of lights and shadows. Sure, the shadows themselves are very basic and not impressive at all, but when you combine all these according to a simple but effective recipe, you get chaos plus a lot equal spectacle. The game also supports EAX version 3.0, but on Windows 10 you will not be able to activate it, unless you use this UAL. Search for it on the internet, I do not offer links. Thank you for understanding this. Anyway, EAX is going to be emulated, so if you want the original experience, you must use Windows XP with an ODG card that has EAX 3.0, not like I did here. And you're golden. Whatever version of the game you have, CD, Steam, GOG, the game will run on a modern computer. Just remember to copy that file. You can use any display you want. The game supports widescreen and 4K. You can use any settings you want, as much anti-aliasing as you want, you'll have very good performance. The engine scales well with modern components. On the minimum requirements, it runs decently, and it looks okay. On the recommended requirements, it runs about the same as on the minimum ones, only that we're using higher resolutions and settings. On a powerful computer from 2005-2006, Fear runs like a champ. The visuals are extremely nice, and if you know how to tweak some settings, Fear is not such a difficult game to run. Fear is not a badly optimized game, on the contrary, it seems to be quite optimized, unlike Doom 3 or Crysis. That said, when you witness something like this, technological capabilities are no longer relevant. Relevant is the shock you feel then and the memory of the moment that you will never forget. Because after all, gaming is not just 0 and 1, state-of-the-art technology and powerful hardware. Gaming is an experience that imprints in your mind unforgettable moments. details that only you know and appreciate, a rare item that fell when you did not expect it, a bullet that you fired with precision, an overtaking you made at the last second to win the race.